Washington, just Bill, who came in, said, I'm going to work last night, and he's got to go to work again very soon, where he works in the Pentagon. There's all sorts of shrine material to what happened 15 years ago.
Oh,
something from New York, something from here, something from the airplane that crashed. So it's heavy and immediate for those of us who are of a certain age who were alive 15 years ago. We have a sense that something really major changed, although there's been tragedy so much in this nation's history, amen, some of it not acknowledged all along the way, and a lot of people having died. Yet this one today, we're going to recognize and to spend just a little bit of time with it. And I'm going to offer into this mix a little song that's part of a larger oratorio that was commissioned for the 50th anniversary, wrong dates, the 60th anniversary of the liberation of the concentration camps in Europe. Remember where all those millions of people were killed. And the piece is written by Stephen Paulus, and it's called In Praise to Be Certain of the Dawn, is what it's called. And this section, called the Hymn to the Eternal Flame, is written specifically to remember the children that died in the Holocaust. And so I offer this into the mix today, because this sense of the eternal flame and God being like that is actually a good thing, right? There's a candle up there that many people say, what's that? And it's something actually that Moses had a conversation with God about. Long time ago, God said, I want you to light something that's going to continue to be lit in the tabernacle, the place that was set for the scriptures and the people to come together. So we have an eternal flame, and that's a good thing. It's a good place to trust that God is real. So I offer the beginning of this song.
Because remember, Moses knows this is a long-term story, right? It is not
generations and generations before. It's a God who has created a beautiful world and then met people like Abraham and Sarah and worked with them and brought the Hebrew people out of slavery, into freedom, into this new place. And just as they're having a bad day and want to worship a golden calf, God is saying, it's time for me to burn them up. So Moses shifts God's mind. Now that is one powerful man, right? Or one courageous man who is so loving. Because you know how annoyed over time he is with these people over the 40 years. Highly annoyed, over and over and over again. But love in faith has a capacity to embrace all manner of annoyances. Moses knows the hearts of these people, knows that they are in God, and Moses changes God's mind so that fire becomes an eternal fire.
Amen.
Not a fire that takes people out. Amen. And we hear in this beautiful song that all of these things are woven into fire. Face and voice and sorrow and pity and love and memory and breath and crying and longing and singing and hope and healing and heart and tongue and trembling and blessing and soul and shining. It's all woven into God. Now this must be some kind of special weaving that God's got going on too. Because you imagine weaving to come to be a piece of cloth and we've got woven into fire. What kind of God is this? Well, I think that God is a friend of my friend who wove this.
Yeah.
God is a friend of Angelica Lopez, who you can meet today, because she'll help serve our refreshments. Angelica made this soap. The first time I saw Angelica's work, I saw it and I said to myself, gosh, what did she do? She went to the Joanne Fabrics and she found a big bolt of cloth and she just cut some things off of it and started making like placemats and napkins. Well, no, completely humbled. Because what did Angelica do? Weave this with her own hands. And I did not believe it. I did not believe it still until she took me amongst a group to her apartment, which is right across the street in this very beautifully modest home. Up against the wall, there is this hook in the wall, and from that there are all these strings and all these slats of wood, and Angelica wraps this thing around her little waist and sits on a little bench on the floor and weaves.
My God. My God.
That is my God. She's so petite, she could like fly out the window, right? Right, this thing is like this huge, I imagine the catapult. But she just puts all these things into this beautiful fabric. Look at all these designs.
Pretty colors.
And she must be a friend of God, teaching God about weaving, bringing forth all these different designs from everything that is woven together. So God has friends like Angelica who weave and teach us about what God can weave into God's heart. God from that story with Moses, and God weaves in hard-headedness and unfaithfulness and forgetfulness. We have this wonderful Psalm 51, and if you know the origins of the psalm, that was our friend David. If you think you have done anything that God cannot forgive, you should read that story of David, right? Because this psalm comes from his realization, and it takes a while when you understand that he did wrong, right? That he had a man killed so he could take his wife. Right? So, you know, if you think you've done something God can't forgive you, well, there's just a lot of evidence against that.
Amen.
In the Bible. Because this time of confession from David allows him to plead to God to create a new heart in him. Right? And, you know, Lutherans like to talk a lot about Reformation, and we think that's really tough. But, you know, this is not like a reformed heart. This is a new heart. Right? So imagine how that change affects you, the sense that God is to take out your old heart and put in a new heart. And that's what David is pleading for. Pleading for that because he gets that the love that God has is not going to kill him if God takes the heart out that's in there and puts the new heart back. So there's something that God has to fold in from this story, too, of David. God folds in betrayal and manslaughter and guilt into fire. And then we have Jesus, who's telling about all these things that are lost, right? All these things that are seemingly inconsequential or on the edge of life or don't really matter. It's just one sheep, right? Just a few coins, right? Jesus is saying, no, those are consequential to God, and God can weave in everything that has been lost into God's heart and into fire. Now, we are here at this time of 9/11, and just think of all the loss that people are agonizing over today. I shared with the children that I saw yesterday an interview with someone on CNN, and this man is the head of a company that occupied floors 100 to 105 in the Twin Towers, and in his company, they lost over 600 people.